Hi, this is Corey Franklin with Remembering the Past, the show where we talk about people who've died recently who've had a profound effect on our history, our society, or our culture. And tonight we're going to travel to Australia to talk about Murray Rose. Murray Rose died recently at the age of 73, and he was one of the greatest swimmers of the 20th century, perhaps the greatest swimmer of the 20th century. He was certainly the greatest swimmer in the world from the decade of about 1955 to 1965. He's widely considered one of the great Australian heroes, and he was involved in one of the memorable moments in Olympic history. Here is Australian television to tell you a little bit about the Australian hero swimmer, Murray Rose.
Australia's sporting community is mourning the loss of Olympic swimming legend Murray Rose. He set 15 world records and was a four-time Olympic gold medalist. He won three golds at the 1956 Melbourne Olympics and one in Rome 4 years later.
He became a household name at 17, winning three gold medals at Melbourne's Olympic Games in 1956. That success continued, taking home a gold, silver and bronze in Rome 4 years later. The first swimmer to win the 400-metre freestyle event twice in a row, an honour now shared with Iain Thorpe. The swimming great was honoured in 1999 as a legend of Australian sport by the Australian Sport Hall of Fame. A torchbearer at Sydney's Olympics, he was also one of just eight flag holders. Swimming Australia released this statement. Murray Rose is a part of the swimming DNA in this country. His success inspired a generation, and our thoughts and prayers are with his family and close friends.
Here's Dawn Fraser, who was the young female swimming star of the Melbourne Olympics, along with Murray Rose.
Fellow Olympic swimming champion Dawn Fraser says his death is a huge loss.
He used to swim every day up until the fact that he got very sick and he couldn't do that anymore.
One of the things I want to emphasize is that there's more of a backstory to Murray Rose than most of the obituaries in the United States covered. And I'm going to do that by reading a little bit from one of the Australian newspapers about his most famous race, the 1500-meter freestyle in 1956. 15 years to the day after the bombing of Pearl Harbor, the sellout crowd in Melbourne's then new Olympic pool had cheered itself hoarse as the world record holder, American swimmer George Breen, led Japan's Tsuyoshi Yamanaka for most of the furious 1500 meters freestyle final. 400 meters from home, the blonde swimmer in lane 5 made his move. Murray Rose, then aged 17, surged. He opened a 4-meter lead, but as the three contenders turned for the final 100 meters, Yamanaka started coming. Across the nation, millions listening to the finals on the radio rose to their feet. In Sydney and Melbourne, crowds gathered in suburban shopping centers to watch the live coverage on, or footage on new black and white television sets on display, and electrical shop windows started to yell. So too did some well-heeled enough to see the swim on home sets. Rose's 1.4-second victory was emblematic to an Australia poised on the edge of golden eras of prosperity and sport. It was a moment burnt into the collective memory of baby boomers and the generations who'd survived the Depression and World Wars. Rose was a stellar member of the 1954-64 decade of athletes who carried post-war Australia onto the world stage. Lou Hode, Betty Cuthbert, Peter Thompson, Ken Rosewall, Jack Brabham, Marjorie Jackson, Herb Elliott, Dawn Fraser, and John Conrads. They and their deeds instilled pride and confidence in a country forced by war and economic circumstances to finally stand on its own feet. And most of you may not understand the significance of that, but let me paint the picture. It's only 11 years after World War II has ended, and Australia is home to the Summer Olympics. During World War II, especially during the early years, 1941, 42, and 43, Australia and their soldiers suffered terribly under the Japanese, who had conquered most of Southeast Asia and Singapore. It was the Australians who did most of the fighting against the Japanese. Australia, while threatened, was never conquered by the Japanese, but they suffered tremendous losses and tremendous brutality under the Japanese, and in fact, that was embodied in one photo. It's a very famous photo of an Australian soldier who is about to be beheaded by a Japanese soldier in Papua New Guinea. The photo was taken, and it was captured off a killed Japanese soldier a little later in the war, and it became an iconic photo that was on Life magazine, and it was played throughout the world. And it burned deeply in the memory of the world and especially in the memory of the Australians. so the Australians retained an animus for the Japanese after World War II. The 1500-meter freestyle in 1956 in Melbourne featured Rose against Yamanaka, and Yamanaka was the Joe Frazier to Rose's Ali. Yamanaka was the second best swimmer in the world, and he once said his goal was always to beat Rose, and he always chased that goal futilely. In the 1500-meter freestyle, which the newspaper described so dramatically, Rose won, and the next day, the day after the anniversary of Pearl Harbor, Yamanaka and Rose posed for a picture hugging together in the pool. And this picture was relayed throughout the world, and it served as a counterpoint to the execution picture during the war. Bud Greenspan, the Olympic historian, described the embrace of Rose and Yamanaka after the 1-2 finish as proof that World War II was finally over. And in fact, it didn't dawn on Rose at the time the significance of that picture. He said, "The significance almost crept up on me. That rivalry, that essential goodwill from people representing nations which had been enemies in a terrible war. It epitomized, in a sense, the Olympic spirit." So the picture of Rose and Yamanaka hugging basically did a lot to erase the animus that the Australians and Japanese felt for each other because of the war a decade earlier. Rose, who was a strict vegetarian, was also a hero in the 1960 Olympics. And he came to the United States to study at the University of Southern California, and he got into the movie game for a little while. He was a sort of a bit player in the movie Ride the Wild Surf, which was one of those early surfing movies in the 60s in the United States. The movie was pretty much dreck. They filmed it with Tab Hunter in Hawaii, but it did have a nice theme song by Jan and Dean.
In Hawaii, there's a place known as Waianae Bay, where the best surfers in the world come to stay.
By being in that movie, it sort of kept him from training for the Olympics for Australia in 1964, where he might have won again. He would have been pitted against the young American hero Don Sholander, but he was still one of the greatest swimmers in the world. He actually did one more movie in 1967. He did Ice Station Zebra with Ernest Borgnine and Rock Hudson. But let's just say Murray Rose was a far better swimmer than he was an actor, and that was the end of his Hollywood career. His Olympic career was over, but he was still revered as Australia's greatest male Olympic hero until the early 2000s when Ian Thorpe emerged. And the interesting thing is that the Australians set up a promotional race in 1998 between the 59-year-old Rose and the 15-year-old Ian Thorpe, who was the next great Australian swimming star. Here is the Sports Illustrated account of that promotional race. It was a promotional stunt, the 1998 freestyle race between the Australian Olympic champion from 1956 and 1960 and his country's best medal hope in 2000. But Iain Murray Rose had never settled for second, not even in an exhibition. Rose climbed into the starting block, bent forward on 59-year-old knees, and dived into the Sydney International Aquatic Center pool, where he soundly beat Ian Thorpe, 15 years old at the time, in a 100-meter race viewed by a national television audience in Australia. "I had a 15-second head start," admits Rose. Rose was good-natured. He was known as the seaweed streak because of his vegetarianism. And as Dawn Frazier said, he would swim every day for the rest of his life. He kept in good shape, and he remained a great hero in Australia. But he'll forever be known as that young, blonde, 17-year-old who hugged Yamanaka in the pool and erased many of the memories of World War II. So we say goodbye to Murray Rose, an Australian Olympic hero, and one of the great athletes and sportsmen of our time. Well, we're going to remain in Australia for our close tonight with Greg Hamm, who died at the age of 58 recently. Greg Hamm was the flautist for Men at Work. Here's Australian television to tell you a little bit about Men at Work and Greg Hamm.
The multi-instrumentalist joined the already formed Men at Work in 1979, helping to establish what would ultimately become one of Australia's greatest musical success stories. The band's debut album, Business as Usual, hit the top of the charts in the US, despite being initially rejected by their label's US office.
Men at Work was first introduced to American audiences in the early 1980s with this little ditty, Who Can It Be?
All that works is to be alone.
And then they followed that up with an international smash that probably became the most familiar Australian song of this generation, Land Down Under. You ask most younger people today what song they know from Australia, and this is the song they'll tell you they know. I said, "Do you speak of my language?" He just smiled and gave me a Vegemite sandwich. And he said, "I come from a land down under. Yeah, that's the first time most people have heard of the Vegemite sandwiches, which they eat in Australia. In any event, Greg Hamm had a famous flute solo in the middle of that, which generated a huge amount of controversy and a well-publicized lawsuit in Australia. Let's hear a little bit of that flute solo. Nice catchy tune. The only problem with it is it might have been a little too catchy. In the 1930s, an Australian schoolteacher wrote a song called Kookaburra Sits in an Old Gum Tree. It became one of those standards that school children sing all over Australia, and they've been singing it for decades. And unfortunately, the music publishing company said that Greg Hamm and Men at Work had ripped off their flute riff from The Land Down Under from Kookaburra Sits in an Old Gum Tree. Here are the school children singing the pertinent verse. Okay, so you got sweet little school children singing a standard school children's song and big soulless music company suing the rock group. Here are the two songs together as they were played in court. Well, you got me. I can't call that one. To me, it's less obvious than George Harrison's My Sweet Lord and the Chiffons' He's So Fine. But apparently the Australian judge found for the publishing company, and they had found that Greg Hamm and Men at Work had ripped off the song from the Larrikin Publishing Company. They lost a bunch of money that they had made on royalties from the song. They incurred huge legal costs, and Greg Hamm's life was never the same after that. So it's a tragic remembrance of what happened to him after their huge number one hit all across the world. So we say goodbye to Greg Hamm, who left us with one of the great flute solos in rock history, even if they did say he ripped it off. I want to thank my producer, Sid Tepps. And since we had an Australian-themed show tonight with Murray Rose and Greg Hamm, so it seems logical to close with an Australian theme. Probably the most well-known of all Australian themes of the 20th century. It's the unofficial national anthem sung by Rolf Harris, the guy who sang Timey Kangaroo Downsport in the 60s, the most famous Australian song of the generation before Land Down Under. Here's Rolf with a couple of overserved Aussies singing a little bit of Waltzing Matilda in memory of Murray Rose and Greg Hamm. You'll come along, Waltzing Matilda, Waltzing Matilda. You'll come along, Waltzing Matilda, with me. And his ghosts may be heard as you pass by that billabong. You'll come along, Waltzing Matilda.